Get ready, it's time for part 6 of the Beginner's Cold Process Soap Making Tutorial. In this episode of Thermal Mermaid, we're going to make the Grapefruit and Bamboo Cliff Dive Drop Swirl Bar. This is part 6 of a 10-part series in Beginning Cold Process for Soap Makers. There are 9 cold process recipes in this series, and this is recipe number 5. If you'd like to download this and all of the recipes in this tutorial, you can find them in the Thermal Mermaid Soap Makers Course and Resources Members Directory. This series can be found under Lesson 2, where all of the recipes are ready to be printed. Now, if you're not a member at Thermal Mermaid, then I warmly invite you over to the Facebook group, where I have uploaded all of the free recipes under the link that says Files. You're welcome to join me and other soap makers over there if you'd like to ask questions or share your creations. Don't forget, if you're a beginner and you find this tutorial helpful, please hit the thumbs up button so that I get an idea if this is the kind of content that you would like me to keep making. Comments are always welcome. If you know a fact or a detail about the topic, feel free to add to the conversation here or over at the Facebook thread. There's only so much that I can fit into a 10-minute video, and some of you out there are a treasure of information, so I invite you to chat up your soaping experiences here too. And of course, don't forget to subscribe so you get all the recipes in this series. In this video, we're going to create a solid bar of soap with a pretty wispy drop swirl of colors. Now, this is the first recipe in the series where we'll focus on keeping the trace thin so that we can get the colors and the swirling patterns into the designs of the bar. In the last episode, we mentioned the term superfat. Now, since this is a really basic term that you'll hear a lot in cold process recipes, I'm going to explain a little bit more about that and talk about how we can use the attribute of superfat as another tool in your belt to control the trace just a little bit, and also this will increase the quality of your bar. So let's begin now. In this recipe, I've added titanium dioxide to the lye water solution and blend this down before adding it to the oils. And this will give me a white base to work with before I add the accent colors. Now, I've made this recipe in a way a lot of new soapers begin. Lots of lightweight vegetable oils. It's cheap to buy in large amounts, it's light colored, so you'll be able to use light micas, and the trace will be water thin for a long time. Now, after one batch of this, you'll quickly learn that your soap can end up soft and spongy. So, you'll need to learn to balance out a combination of olive and coconut oils that will make it a more stable bar. But still, a canola soap isn't the most luxurious thing out there. So let's talk about how to take less expensive average oils and turn it into something nice. We're going to add a small amount of rich shea butter and castor oil to the recipe. The shea butter will give the bar a creamy, moisturizing effect, while the castor oil will increase the lather. Now, both of these accelerate trace, so each one is only 5% of the recipe. Now, in the last episode, you heard me say that we gave our salt bar a superfat to keep it from feeling dry. And we're going to do that again, but this time, instead of just adding a percent of oils, we're going to be very specific about which oils we allow to become the superfat. So to recap, when the oils and lye combine, they bond and become soap. They're no longer oil nor lye, so it really doesn't matter what kind of oil you use, it all becomes soap. Now, they might hold different properties, but soap is soap. Once the two parts have been given time to bond, you can then add the richest and most expensive oils into the recipe to ensure that doesn't turn into soap, but they'll be the oil that the user feels on their skin. In this case, we want the shea butter to float in the bar. So voila, we get a bar that's inexpensive to make, but with the luxury properties that one wants to feel with an expensive bath product. Now, this is a handy way to create your recipe when you want to make something nice, but you don't live in a market where people will pay $9 or $12 for a bar of soap. So what happens to the recipe when you add a superfat? When you make a 3-pound batch of soap, the amount of oils will never change. You still need 3 pounds or 48 ounces of oil. It's the amount of lye that changes in your recipe. So if you want to create a 5% superfat, you'll reduce the amount of lye needed to eat the oil so that 5% of your oils are left over. So a recipe with no superfat will have a larger amount of lye than a recipe with a 5%, a 10%, or a 20% superfat. Now, how does this relate to the trace of your recipe? Well, since a small part of the oils are not going to saponify, it changes the texture just a little bit, and the trace is more likely to stay more thin when you add a higher superfat. In this recipe, shea butter is our superfat, but we're preventing it from bonding with the lye, mostly, so it won't contribute to accelerating the trace. Now, castor oil is another story, but we're sticking to the beginner material. And also, you want to know that you need to use the freshest oils for your superfat. Since they're not going to turn into soap, they can still go rancid over time, and this will appear in the form of orange spots, but we'll go into that in another video. Whenever I use a reference to less expensive oils, I only mean that in respect to actually more expensive and exotic oils, like the jojoba and the vitamin E. I don't really ever mean oils that are on discount because they're about to expire, or something that you're gonna find in a, you know, half-off slashed bin because the oils are out of season or out of date. It's important that you're always purchasing the freshest oils that you can buy, no matter what the price. So the message here is, if you combine your recipe with a good balance of oils and butters, you don't have to be afraid of using a large amount of lightweight oils like the canolas and the vegetable oils, and you can use this to your advantage when you want to design that wispy swirl soap batter. In the drop swirl scene here, I've poured the white base into the mold, and I'm holding each color several inches over the batter, pouring from a height, which will allow the color to go deeper into the soap. I'll keep alternating these colors, and I have a little bit of control based on how high I pour over the mold. The drop swirl itself is very simple, and you only need to see it once to get the idea. Once I'm finished, we'll let this set up for 24 hours, and we'll come back to cut when it's ready. Now, as we cut this open, you can get a glimpse of that random entropy that the drop swirl creates, a real artisan soap, because no two pieces will ever be alike. Now, this will need 4 to 6 weeks to cure, and it will be ready to use after that. Next up, part 7. Stay tuned for a great hanger swirl recipe that will get you those designs that you've seen all over the internet.